This episode is sponsored by Fire and Fuel Coaching, where I help you discover who you are and where you want to go, both on and off the job. For more information, please reach out to me at my Instagram handle at Jerry Fire and Fuel.
Thank you for listening to Enduring the Badge podcast. I'm your host, Jerry Dean Lund, and I want to personally thank you for listening. Don't forget to rate and review the show wherever you access your podcast. If you know someone that would be great on the show, please get a hold of me at Jerry Fire and Fuel on Instagram, and also you can reach out to me on Enduring the Badge podcast on Instagram as well. Remember, the views and opinions expressed during the show represent our guests and hosts alone.
Welcome to Enduring the Badge podcast. My special guest today is Jeremy Sanders, and you started a Facebook and an Instagram page called Crew First Culture.
Yes, sir. I've kind of been going on with that probably 6 months or so now. It's kind of a way that I've learned to get some things out that maybe have led to some frustration if I didn't. So been a good tool for myself, really.
That's great. Tell us a little bit about yourself. Tell us about your family and where you grew up.
So currently family situation is I live with my wife and five of our seven kids in a really small town, kind of southwest of Tulsa, and we have a 10-acre farm, quite a few animals, nothing big, but got a bunch of goats and donkeys and chickens and cats and dogs. So a couple of our kids have moved out, like I said, but we still have quite a few at home, and wife is a full-time nurse, I'm a full-time firefighter, and then you throw in a farm and five or six kids here any day of the week, and it's always a busy time. There's always something going on for sure.
Oh yeah, I can imagine.
As far as growing up, that's probably one of the harder questions that anybody ever asked me, because I don't ever know how to answer that. You know, I was born in Texas. We lived in California some when I was a baby that I have no idea, you know, any remembers about. Lived in Oklahoma till about third grade. Then I moved around four or five places in Arkansas till I was in like the third grade or eighth grade. Then moved back to Oklahoma. And since moving back, kind of basically resided around central Oklahoma area. So I guess you would say I'm from central Oklahoma. That's about the best way to do it, because we've moved around a lot. So that's kind of the story behind that. But
yeah, well, probably helped you get some diversity in moving around the country like that.
Yeah, for sure.
So I know you're very passionate about your Instagram, Facebook page, but what else are you passionate about?
Oh, family, really. I mean, it's just always been something that's been really, really big to me. Been a lot of life experiences that we've all had to go through. My wife and I have been married going on just a little over 5 years now. And the paths that have brought us to each other have been filled with trauma and, you know, very rich life experiences, I would say. And so, you know, it's for both of us and for all of us, really, all the kids too, it's very nice to be in a place. No, it's not perfect. I would never say that. And, you know, there's always issues or something going on. So, you know, you got this many kids, somebody's always in trouble. So there's always things to deal with, but to be in a place to where we're at right now, to have the family that we have and have somebody that is there for you to the extent that each of us has, it's very nice to be able to just have that comfort and, you know, that stability from somebody, from both of us, my wife and I. I've kind of gone through some really hard times. So family has always been really big to me. I can't say it enough. I'm not even close to the perfect dad. This whole quarantine, kids at home, going to school stuff has been very eye-opening to me as far as I am not a teacher and I struggled at it, and that I feel very bad about it, but I'm just not a great teacher. So it's definitely showed me that I've got some areas that I need to get better for sure. But yeah, that's kind of the main thing.
You're in the same boat as probably every single person listening to this. Very few people I've talked to is like, feel like they're doing a great job of being a parent at home, and it's challenging. I'm sure you're a great teacher at the fire department and, you know, as a captain, but this is a whole nother level of trying to teach your kids. And yes. And if you're like me, like they show you your homework and stuff like that, I'm like, this is not how we did it. And I cannot help you.
Yeah, exactly. I have never felt more dumb in my life than trying to explain stuff to a sixth grader and even a second grader right now. It's just ridiculous.
Yeah. It's tough, but you know, we just make it through it. Hopefully the school year, the upcoming school year actually happens and starts. I think every parent in the world is praying that happens, so life can go back to some normal scene.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So do they help you out on the farm, the kids?
Yeah, we've got a very wide, well, with as many as we have, just like anything, you know, you like the people you work with. The more people you work with, you have a wider and wider range of, you know, characteristics and personalities. And so with seven, we have a very wide range of personalities. We've got some very outgoing kids that you can't hardly keep inside, and we've got some very, very other end of the spectrum kids that we can't hardly get out of their rooms. So some of them are more excited about helping than others, but there's always something to do. So we try to get them out there and, get their hands kind of busy and things like that. But some are a little bit easier to get out than others.
Yeah, it's funny. They can have the same parents and definitely have different personalities.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, for sure.
So why'd you want to become a first responder?
To be honest, I don't know that I ever remember really wanting to as a younger kid. You know, I know my dad did a little bit of volunteering for – it couldn't have been for more than a couple years, you know, when I was really young. So I wasn't really around fire service or anything like that at all. I think it just matches my personality. You know, I had a few instances when I was kind of in between high school and college age where I was putting some spots to be able to help some people, like in a, we were doing a river float trip one time and kind of got to help a couple people there that got swept away. And then one time when we were in Mexico, there was a guy that was parasailing and basically got wrapped up and caught in the ocean and was able to help, you know, get that person back. And just a couple things like that just kind of led me to want to do that more often. And I think that's a little piece of it, but I think a bigger piece of it is just, I've always been a sports guy, love playing sports and love the environment that the team always brought. And in my early 20s, I was working with a couple guys that were firefighters in towns around that, you know, they were doing their side jobs with me, and just kind of listening to them talk kind of led me into thinking maybe this is something that really would kind of fit along with me. And I think that's one of the bigger things right now is just being involved in that team atmosphere, and really it's the family atmosphere. It's just another family. So that's kind of the journey I took. It definitely wasn't, you know, I was always around it, lived with it, you know, grew up with it. None of that. It just kind of, it found me, I would say, more than anything.
What was your first job?
Man, I've worked so many jobs.
What was your first job in the fire service?
A lot of crappy jobs.
Yeah.
First job in I've actually only taken one test. I took the test for the department that I currently work at when I was 24, got hired on there, and that's it. I've been at the same place for 18 years. So it's Edmond, Oklahoma is where it is. It's basically the suburb just north of Oklahoma City.
Okay.
So I've got about 100 miles commute from where I live to where I work.
And what size of department is that?
We have five stations. We've got, suppression-wise, we got around, I believe, 110, 115-ish. Usually carry about 33, 35 a shift, basically.
That's right. Is your area pretty big to cover? Got a wild, you know,
range? We've got 100 square miles, which it's a big area. We've got quite a bit of that that's kind of rural, really low populated. It's kind of funny because we're basically split in half by I-35, and, you know, a major interstate. And anything on the west side it's not so much now because they're kind of moving everything out that way. But as just historic-wise, anything west of I-35 has been no hydrants, you know, really low populated area. Anything east of there has been kind of the main bulk of all that population. So it's a very good mix of almost, I mean, we've got a major interstate. We've got railroad tracks that go through our city. We've got heavily populated areas. We've got rural areas of just farms. So it's got quite a little bit of everything.
Yeah, that sounds like a good mix. Sounds like you're going to get a lot of varying calls, which is always fun because it's challenging your skills and knowledge. And
yep.
I like that about the kind of area that I work in now. It's just a very long and skinny city, but we're up against the base of a mountain on one side of our city, and then on the other side of the city that borders us is a lake. So get lots of good and varying calls, and makes it so you keep up on your training.
Oh, yeah.
So can you explain to me a little bit about a day in the life of being a first responder and having a wife as a nurse? That might make things a little more challenging than managing your schedules and depending on what shift she's working.
Yeah, we definitely have to be very intentional about things or just stuff falls away. You know, it just gets forgotten. And I'm the world's worst about keeping up with appointments and things like that. I can't tell you how many appointments that I've missed, and I'm terrible at that. So I'm trying to always trying to figure out ways of reminding myself or of things like that. But really, I mean, if you're talking about kind of off duty, you know, right now with the kids home, I basically race home right after shift because I've got a 9-year-old that still functions as about a 4-year-old. He can't be trusted with anything. So my wife gets up around 3 o'clock most days to get into work in Tulsa around 4:30 at the very latest. So she's gone a few hours before I can get home. You know, I'll get home and kind of start getting them up. We do a little bit of school stuff, trying to stay on top of that. It's kind of funny because I'd gotten to a really good routine of when I came home. You know, I would be listening to podcasts and things like that, and kind of got my mind going on different topics. So I would come home and basically spend, you know, an hour or two just either writing or just something to kind of get that stuff out. And this whole routine has kind of blown up. So trying to find a balance of still giving myself some of that time, and not spending all day secluded from the kids, because that's just, it's not good. But we try to get outside, especially when it's nice, and we'll do some hiking in the woods behind us, or we've got a lake at the end of our road that we'll go out to, or just go out and spend some time with the animals. You know, just that's something that we have been very, very lucky during this situation with, is because, you know, yes, we're quarantined or whatever you want to call that, but I literally can walk out of my house and go for a hike, or I can walk out of my house and go to the lake and, you know, go pet animals. I basically live at a petting zoo, and it's just been very nice to be able to have that as a way to kind of debrief and get some stress off. Because if I personally, just speaking for myself, if I lived in town or if I lived in an apartment, I would not be in a good place mentally. I'm not like that. I couldn't be able to be just pinned up all the time. So it's been nice for me for sure to have that.
But yeah, I think as a first responder, I think most of us don't want to be cooped up, right? It's even if we're cooped up in the firehouse for an extended period of time, we struggle with that. But yeah, if your living situation's a little bit different and you do live in a, you know, a city where you can't get out and do those things, that would be incredibly tough, especially during this time.
My wife just took, I'm sorry. Yeah.
No, go ahead.
I was just going to say, my wife had just recently taken a job to get some better hours. She used to be an acute dialysis nurse, which is basically you're there until your patients are gone. So it would be 6, 7, 8, 10, 3 o'clock in the morning sometimes before she got home. So she has taken a job just recently with chronic dialysis, which is like the clinic. So is now basically a set schedule. You know, she goes in super early, like I said, but she'll get off around noon to one every day. So that's been, we haven't experienced a lot of it because she just started, but it's going to be really nice to have at least some type of kind of structure with her being able to come home every day at a certain time. So that's going to be really nice.
Yeah. I mean, that's a helpful, right? The kids need a schedule, especially right now, because they're bucking any kind of schedule at home, I think, for the most part. And so having her home, that sounds like it's going to be a great help. Has there been a time in your life where this, you know, career of being a firefighter has consumed you?
I think it comes in waves. And I mean, I'm not speaking for anybody else, but I would think that it kind of is the same for everybody. It's just, it's funny if me personally, just looking at my career and my life during that, my personal life, it's almost like there's been times where I have basically been saved because I was a firefighter, because that was the only good part of my life. Just making it through the days at home so I could go to work and be able to kind of let some of that stress out. That was my out then. But I've also been a part of some crews at work that I couldn't hardly stand to be at work. I hated where I was and all this. And then it was almost like it flopped to where I was just barely making it home so that I could be away from work for a while. And then, you know, it's weird, the dynamics, you know, the different crews you're on, different situations you're on at dealing with at home. And since my wife and I have been together, you know, I was basically a good place at both work and home. And I was really enjoying being at home. So I kind of stepped away from everything. Basically, when I left work, I just left work and I did not think about it at all. Not because I didn't enjoy what I was doing then. It was just, I was really consumed with getting a new family started and all the things that were going on with us. And now that, you know, we're settled and a couple years down the road, I've kind of started to, I guess just reignite the passion I had for everything, and you know, a new role as far as being a captain here a couple years ago has just really kind of set me up to grow and learn, and so I'm kind of now wanting to get back into going to some conferences and things like that, just really hungry to learn. So basically, to answer your question and a long way around, I guess, is I don't think there's ever been a time that I've just been truly consumed by it and or allowed it to be to consume me. But there's always been a balance that I've had to try to find of, you know, too much work. You're starting to forget the home life. If you're too involved at home and you kind of let yourself go on the work side and lose some passion for the training and the working out and all that. So it's always been something that I've tried to really keep some type of a balance of focus on both, really. So
I think you're dead on. I think that's something I've dealt with through my career is, you know, those ups and downs of home life, work life, making that balance. Sometimes things are not so good at work and they're not so good at home, and just managing those back and forth. So I think you're spot on. I think you feel like, at least you're talking to me, you're talking my language. Like I feel the same way.
Yeah.
At work, do you feel like you can express your feelings and thoughts and at work, or is it hard to do that there?
No, I think my career is, I'm trying to think of the right way to say this. I think the time that I came on was a very interesting time from now, you know, because no, I've only been on 18 years. I'm not, you know, these old salty guys that have been on for, you know, 25, 35 years. But when I came on, it seems like there has already been a big shift in that, because I think when I came on, I kind of hit the tail end of that, you know, firefighters are made of steel and ladders are made of wood, you know, all that whole deal. And I think a lot of the older guys that were there when I came on were that mentality of, you don't talk about stuff, you just deal with it, because that's what we do. And if you have a problem with it, then you might not need to be here, basically. And I think a lot of that mentality, a lot of those firefighters are gone, and you see, especially on social media, you're seeing a lot of people and a lot of groups kind of starting to focus on, you know, that mental health issue and kind of being open and honest and stuff like that. So I definitely think that just in my 18 years, I've been a part of a very big swing in that, and I think that's awesome. I think that's probably one of the best things that has happened to the fire service since I've been on, is just the shedding of that ego and that, you know, mentality of, we don't need to ask for help because, you know, we're grown, for better words, if we're grown men, we can handle it, blah, 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 that stupid stuff. And so as far as just personal wise, I'm a part of a very good crew right now. You know, I've only got, we're a small station. It's 5 people, including myself, but we have discussions very regularly about talking about dealing with things that, you know, need to be dealt with, about mental health type stuff. So I feel like we're very free with how we are mentally and just talking. So I think just personally wise, I'm in a good place right now for sure.
Is that something you facilitate as the captain, or is your crew kind of, I mean, do you set up meetings to have those discussions, or is this casual conversation around the dinner table?
A little both. I was just recently kind of introduced to being a part of our peer support group by the guy that runs it. And that kind of spurred a lot of thought for me. To be honest, I have, just as a general rule, have really avoided the mental health aspect of firefighting. you know, when I see podcasts that deal with it, I'm not going to click on it. I don't want to be involved in it. I would rather hear something about leadership or something about tactics. It's always been hard for me to spend time doing that and basically immersing myself in that, because I feel like it was almost a kind of a way to avoid a trigger for myself, you know, just dealing with a lot of personal things in my past. I just wanted to be listening to the happy things, you know. I didn't want to be listening to all that stuff. And and so being put in the place of that peer support group, I've kind of started to realize that, yes, I think I have some things to say to help people with leadership and culture and things like that. But if I was really being real with myself, I think I have a lot more that I can give in the realm of mental health and support and things like that. It's just going to be a lot harder for me to step up in that area, because, you know, that's not the fun stuff to talk about. That's not the fun stuff to deal with. So I think that as much as I would like to not be the case, that's really something that I'm going to have to branch out and explore a lot more of.
Yeah. Is that something that you're going to like personally look into training, just like maybe online or go to classes or read books, or where do you think you're going to be able to get that information from?
Man, I honestly don't know. I don't know where this path is going to take me. I couldn't imagine that I'm at where I'm at right now, just kind of starting, like you started out talking to the social media thing. Is just, I'm a part of a bigger plan. This thing is way bigger than me. I'm basically just kind of trying to keep my eyes open to what is the next step. You know, before the show, you know, I've talked to you a little bit about kind of messing around with trying to attempt some podcast stuff. And I just feel like, you know, when I find something like the Instagram, I find it feels good. It's nice to be able to reach out to more people and do something, but then it quickly turns into, man, there's something more. What's next? And so it turns to writing, and then it's good. And then it's like, there's gotta be something else. So then maybe it's podcasting. So it just feels like I got to be kind of mindful of what's next. I have no plans at all. It's just, I'm trying to keep my eyes open. And just like you, you know, asking me to be on your show, first of all, I'm very thankful for that. I really appreciate you bringing me on. But just anything that I see that, hey, maybe this is a chance to kind of get something out there. And so I'm basically, what I'm saying is I'm just along for the ride, and whatever opportunities are brought in front of me, I'm going to try to take advantage of them.
Yeah, I think you got it. I mean, being open and just being mindful that things coming your way, you're definitely going to have things coming to you that are going to steer you in the direction that you want to go. So I think that's awesome. Yep. That you're open-minded like that. So just describe, I mean, you described a little bit about the bond that you have with your crew. Maybe describe it just a little bit, you know, more. What does that look like at work? Because I know you're following your page and stuff like that. You guys do a fair amount of training. And so what else happens around the firehouse?
Yeah, I'm very lucky to have a group of people that are just, they're willing to put their needs and their selfishness aside to be a part of the group. You know, it's very interesting. If you knew the people that I have, I have such a wide range. I've got a range of people that are fine with not doing hardly any training, all the way up to people that would train all day, every day, and just love doing anything and everything. And that was when we first got together 2 years ago, well, basically probably about a year and a half ago, that was a concern of mine because the personalities were so different, and even mine from some of them. And if I didn't have a group of people that are mature enough to put that aside for the overall group, I'm losing my words here, but just willing to put that aside for the group, it would be a mess. It would be a terrible place to be, but they are great at meeting each other in the middle. We really have gotten into doing a lot of training. This whole quarantine thing has been, it's been a growing process for us all. We all kind of allowed it to get us into a pretty good slump. You know, we went probably week and a half, maybe even more, of just, part of it was just what the life that we were having to live. We were getting bombarded with policies every hour. And it seemed like every 30 minutes we would have to sit down at the table to discuss something new. And we had no time for ourselves to do anything. And that kind of led into, you know, just basically getting to the station and being locked in that, you know, those walls, doing nothing but the few calls that were running. And so we had a kind of a wake up moment last week to where we really had a couple of my firefighters step up and say, you know, I apologize for kind of allowing us to slip and not be very motivated to do anything. And I'm ready to get back at it. And so this last week we got back into doing some things, and we have a hydrant right in front of our station. And basically most of the stuff we've done is basically just bringing out some hose, hooking it to a hydrant and just doing something. Just getting out and being out in the sun and getting out of the house. And it's been so nice to kind of get back in that swing of things again. We've got some try to work out together, but that's a little bit, I think just working out at the same time is basically a win for us. There's some guys that like to do CrossFit stuff. There's some guys like myself that hate CrossFit stuff. So, that doesn't always mesh up together, but at least we're out there together. We like to play pickleball together. It's a good team sport to get us involved, do some video games at night when we're not running calls. We kind of do our own thing for breakfast, but we always eat together. Lunch is kind of the same way. Dinner is always together. We eat in the station, I'd say probably 95% of the time. We don't hardly ever go out to eat. It's always kind of rotating around. We've got several of the crew that'll cook. So I am the kind of guy that just likes to be around my people. And I'm lucky enough to be around people that are willing to be like that. You know, we are in a very small station. It's a tiny little station. So it's hard to find hiding spots if that's the kind of person you are anyway. But we're together all day long. I mean, from 6:30 in the morning when we get there till sometimes 11, 12 o'clock at night, we are together. And it's not because I demand it. It's just because we enjoy being together. And it is so awesome to be a part of a crew that just enjoys being together. I mean, it's not as common as you would think and you would hope. So this is by far the most fun I've ever had on the department. And it's nice to be in the spot that I'm at, that, you know, I'm kind of in charge of this, but at the same time, it allows me to really enjoy it even more. So it's nice.
Yeah, no, it sounds awesome. So it sounds like you have a really tight bond with your crew. Does that allow you to share things with them that you may wouldn't share with other crews?
Yes. Yeah, I think so. There's a couple of my firefighters that I've been with most of my career, another one probably 10 years or so. I've been on a lot of tough scenes with several of these guys. And so we've already had a lot of experiences to share, or that we've just shared personally, just being there. So there's a good foundation there. One of my firefighters is new. He's just barely crossed the 1 year, having a 1 year on, and he's only been on my crew for probably not even a month now. So we're kind of getting him into it, getting him involved, having him grow as part of our crew. And so, yes, it makes it easier when you have that relationship kind of already. We're, for some reason, my district is just a district that historically has the most critical calls. You know, we seem to have the most full arrests than anybody else. We have a lot of suicides and just a lot of bad stuff for some reason happens in our district. So it's a district that you need a good crew, a good close crew to run, because you're running and you're running on a lot of stuff that is, if you don't deal with it, it's going to build up. So,
do you have a certain way that you deal or debrief after those stressful calls?
We like to sit down. We spend a lot of time at the table.
Formal or informal.
Yeah. I would say 90% of the time everything is informal. If there's something that is really serious, I've only, just thinking back, I probably have only been a part of maybe two or three formal debriefings since I've been on. And should it be more than that? Absolutely. There's been a lot of other times that probably should have been, but those were some big time events. But most of our stuff is informal. We're a substation that's in the northwest corner of our city, kind of on an island. We're left alone a lot, and that's, to me, I love it. It gives me the opportunity to use skills as an officer a lot more than somebody in town right next to the battalion chief would be able to use. So in addition, that also puts me in a spot to where I need to make sure that everything is dealt with mentally and things like that on our own as well. So I would say pretty much all of it is just informal meetings, sitting down at the table, checking on each other. If there's something going on that somebody seems off, then you'll see myself or just anybody else going to checking on them kind of behind the scenes if that needs to be done too. So it depends on your personality. Some people are more able to talk just one-on-one behind the scenes. Some people just okay with spilling it right there in front of everybody. So it's always situational dependent and personality dependent.
Yeah, for sure. There are people who don't want to be vulnerable in front of other people. And that's a tough thing about in the fire service is, people willing to be vulnerable. In the day room, sitting around the table talking about things that bother them, or out on the training ground, right? That's that vulnerability of like, we don't know it all and we're not perfect is kind of tough to shed sometimes.
Oh yeah. That's one thing that probably one of the biggest things that I want to bring in to the culture of my station is just being humble. And that's across the board. Being humble, like what you just said, of saying, I've been on 18 years, but there is very little that I would say I'm really confident at. There are so many areas of my job that I need a lot of work in. And there's areas of being humble as far as like what we're talking about, mental health, of just saying, man, I'm having a hard time with this. I don't understand why. I've dealt with things worse than this before. but I'm just struggling with it. You know, that's being humble too. And all those things, it takes courage to be that guy, you know, to be that person, to say, I suck at this. You're better at me than this, even though you have a year on and I have 18 years on. Help me. So that's one thing that just the culture that I want to have as my station, it basically revolves around that air of humbleness and that characteristic. So makes a big deal, makes a big difference.
Yeah. Yes, it does. Is there something that you wish you were doing or you learned earlier on in your career? You know, it can be physical or mental health or emotional stuff. Is there something that, looking back at your career, that you would change?
I think the biggest thing in that area is just staying at it, staying motivated, staying inspired. Because like I said earlier, you know, my career has went in waves, and I'm not a lazy person at all, but I have definitely experienced some times where I just could not get myself to work out at all. There have been times where I have had negative attitudes about training. And I think a lot of that was just product of the environment that I was in. And so if I could go back and tell myself anything, would be to be the person that creates that product of the environment, not the person that is negatively affected by that product. You know, the environment is just being the positive influence, no matter what you're facing. You know, if you have a drive to train more, don't let anybody snuff that out. You know, if you have a drive to do anything positive, it's so important to keep that going, to stay inspired and stay passionate. And so I think that would be the biggest thing, is just to not lose a lot of that I have kind of lost and gained again.
Yeah, it's I think a lot of, like you're saying, the balance in our careers, there's just lots of waves and ups and downs. You know, it's hard to balance all that out with what's going on at the station, what's going on in your personal life.
Yeah, for sure.
With those type of things going on, have you ever felt like there's a time when you lost some empathy either for your patients or for yourself, just, you know, through those ups and downs?
Oh yeah. Yeah. And I don't, if there are people that go 25, 30, 35 years and not experience that, that's very impressive to me. And that's kind of something that I'm, it's kind of coming to light to me here just recently, is, you know, you talk to any brand new person that just joined the fire service or is about to join the fire service, and you ask them, why do you want to be a firefighter? And I guarantee you 99.9% of them are going to say, because I want to help people. And I don't think any of them are lying. That's exactly what I said. And that's the saying that you say. But I think that if you don't have more than that, you're going to get burned out, and you're going to lose a lot of that compassion, because it's got to be more than that. Cause you're going to start running on people that you see 7 days a month, just that, you know, they are just going to get medicine. You know, they're going to get their meds, and it's so obvious. And there's people that are literally in a house full of, you know, people that can drive, and their toe hurts, and you're going to load them up in an ambulance to take them to the hospital. It's like, why are we here? What are we doing here? And I think if you don't kind of reach out and find more in-depth reasons for being here, that just to help others is gonna, you're gonna lose that. You know, I have kind of started digging into that, and I think my original answer of to help others like I said, is it's true, but it has gone so far deeper than that now. It's to build tomorrow's leaders. You know, it's to help the circle of influence that I have grow and be better. And yes, to help the citizens, but not just the citizens, to help the men and women that we work with, you know, to be able to help these people not only reach their potential, but blow past it. And that's kind of, like I said, it's something that's just kind of starting to come to me, that we all start by the thought process of wanting to help others. But if you don't ever dig deeper than that, I feel like that's a recipe for losing a lot of compassion, losing a lot of empathy, because people are going to fail you as far as that goes. It's going to make you really question of, I'm here because I want to help people, but am I really helping people? Because all I'm doing is, you know, picking this person up for the 20th time in 3 weeks, you know what I mean? And so yeah, that's kind of something I'm learning right now is that it's a lot deeper question than, you know, a newer person would really look into.
So with your crew first, Instagram and Facebook page, are you digging into that a little bit or expressing yourself through that page about these ideas or your feelings?
Absolutely. Thoughts? I mean, as far as that thought, like I said, that's something that I'm just kind of exploring right now. But all of that was basically born out of frustration. And it's funny because I've heard a lot of other people that have pages kind of express the same thing, is you get into these stages of your life of growth and passion where you just want to suck up the knowledge and everything that you can get. And I wanted to share it so much. I wanted to help people so much. And yes, it's so nice to have my little circle of influence of my station of four other people. But I just felt like there was so much more out there that I needed to be doing. So I wanted to kind of get involved in the department of doing things like that. And I just wasn't allowed to do it. You know, I just never got any doors open as much as I tried to volunteer and all that. So it really led to a lot of frustration for me and anger and irritation. And the Instagram, the Facebook kind of opened doors for me to get some of that out in a good way, and not in a way that I let it build up and shoot out angry, crappy emails to people above me trying to show them how frustrated I am. And that if I allowed myself to get to that point, that basically corrupts everything that I'm trying to get out there. So to find good positive outlets has been kind of my search, and that's what has led me to the Instagram and Facebook and writing some articles. It's been really helpful to, like I said, I listen to a lot of podcasts. So usually I kind of get either going to work or coming home, and some topic will kind of get in my head, you know, and that'll be kind of what I'm fixated on. And if I don't take the time to write something to get that out, they start building up and it starts really kind of messing with me, because I've got to get this stuff out. And you know, I look back at kind of when I first started, and I see a lot of frustration and anger in the things I wrote, and I did not want to be that person. You know, I wanted to spread positivity. I wanted to spread some inspiration if I could do it, to speak to others. But I also have kind of noticed that I want to spread some life lessons, some mistakes. You know, there's been a few times where I've screwed up something at work, and it's been a process for myself to allow myself to forgive myself. I said to myself like 10 times, but allow myself to forgive me for doing that and kind of putting that out there over the social media has been the last steps of finally releasing that from me. And so I think it's important. Yeah, it's good to be motivated and to see people dominating these home workouts and, you know, staying motivated even though they're stuck at home. But I think it's just as important to see these people that are saying, man, I'm struggling with this being a home thing. I'm not doing well at it. I'm not staying motivated. You know, but these are some things that I'm kind of using to get past it. And so there's so many different levels that social media can help. And I'm just trying to kind of touch on as many of those as I can.
So why the name Crew First Culture?
Just as self-explanatory as it can be. My kind of my mentality, my focus as a leader or as a captain at my station is that my crew comes first. I treat them. I want to treat them as best as I can. I want to take care of them as best as I can. I want them to know that I will have their back and I need to follow through with that. And I do that because I know that if I take care of them, if I treat them as best as I possibly can, that they will do every single thing that they can to complete whatever task is put in front of them. And that really, it came from some podcasts listening to kind of how Southwest Airlines runs their business. You know, they kind of paraphrasing, but they treat their people like family because they know that their employees will treat the customers like family. And that's, I honestly, now that I kind of have learned that mindset, I don't see how more people don't believe in it, because it's just human nature to take care of those who take care of you. I mean, if you have somebody that treats you like crap and kind of asserts themselves through the authority of their rank and that's the kind of supervisors they are, nobody is going to go out of their way to do a better job at what they're doing for that person. You know, how hard are you going to, or how much harder are you going to work for the person that, you know, will go up to the boss in front of him and basically get himself in trouble speaking up because he feels like, you know, you were treated wrong. You know, that's the kind of person that employees want to work hard for. And that's the kind of person I want to be, because to be honest, that's the kind of person I want to work for myself. So Crew First is just kind of, I'm a big kind of, you know, it kind of has to look good. It's got to sound good. So I kind of played with some things, but it's so basic, just Crew First Culture, because I want a culture that puts my crew first, because if I do, I know that the citizens will be in the best possible place that they could be, because that crew is going to take care of them. Number one.
I totally agree with you. Totally agree with you. I'm sure there's some people that probably wouldn't agree with that, but you know, I've been a part of a couple of crews that I work for the police department here, and their police chief is very, you know, crew or, you know, put the guys first. And he knows if he does everything he can to take care of the guys, just like you're saying, they will always take care of the citizens and they will always take care of the problems as they come up the best that they can before they ever get to him.
Yeah. And I've kind of, to be honest, I've, after creating that, you know, we see a lot of this for them movement, and I kind of felt like, oh crap, you know, am I going to be going against that type of mentality? And I can see from the looking at it from a ways away. Yeah. Those two things, they don't mesh, but I think they're the same thing. And I think they're for the same goal, because like I said, if I'm taking care of them and putting them in the best possible place to succeed, then that's the best place that I can put them for the citizens, and the citizens as the best possible people coming to take care of them, because they've got the best attitude and they're ready to go. So it, if you're just looking at it from a 30,000 feet view, yeah, it's like, okay, you got crew first culture, but then is that different from for them, because you're putting those guys first and not the citizens? Well, it's basically just semantics, man. You just, you know what I mean? It's just kind of different ways you're saying it, but we're all in it for the same thing. We're all in it to take care of the people we're here to take care of.
Yeah. There's many ways to get that job done. Any regrets being a first responder?
Oh, no, I'm trying to find I don't know that there's many regrets. Like I said earlier, I think if I could have leveled out a little bit of the ups and downs that I experienced, I think that's probably a regret of just allowing myself to be more of a negative person than I really wish I would have been. I wish I would have kind of gotten some of this passion earlier, but that's something that you can't really control. You're just, it's just, it hits you when it hits you. And so I'm not perfect. I've not done perfect things. There's lots of maybe scenes and incidents that probably I wish could have went differently, but just looking at it generically for my career, just being more positive when I wasn't, and that's probably the biggest thing I would say.
What do you feel is your greatest accomplishment?
I think just seeing, like right now, you know, I've got some people on my crew that have been there for a while, some firefighters. And these firefighters, I feel like, have never really been pushed to be leaders. You know, they're guys that have seen a lot of stuff. They've gotten a lot of experience, but they have never really went outside their comfort zone of using that experience to help others. And so my personal, just if I think back on the proudest thing that I've been a part of, is just pushing these guys to become that senior firefighter that they can be, you know, using their voice, using their experience, using their influence to reach out and to help the younger firefighters coming on. Just seeing somebody get to levels that they themselves did never think that they could reach, of just being a type of leader that, you know, I don't honestly care if you ever want to promote. You know, if you want to be a firefighter for 35 years, I, as a captain, don't care. I'm not going to push anybody into something that they don't want to do. But that being said, if you're a 20-year firefighter, a 25, 30-year firefighter, you have got to use that experience to help those below you. You've got to, because we don't have a lot of that. You know, there's not a lot of people that are happy with just staying as a firefighter. And like I said, that's not bad, but you have got to use that experience in good ways. And just being able to challenge my crew. And it's funny, because sometimes I almost find it a fun game of challenging them in ways that they don't really even know. Just kind of going behind the scenes and putting a bug in their ear of kind of getting them to step outside of that comfort zone. And so really that's what does it for me. That it's more, it's so much pride And yes, I'm doing the right thing. I'm doing good things because I see those guys that have never really stepped out to be a leader, to step up and to kind of get themselves growing towards the next level. That's kind of what I would say is the biggest thing.
What do you want others to learn from you?
Oh, Anna, I'm still learning myself a lot. So,
it's an ongoing process, right?
Yeah. I just take care of each other. I mean, that's the biggest thing. If this job is the funnest isn't a word, I get it, but this job is the funnest job in the world. It's the best job in the world. And you literally have to try hard to make it suck. I don't get it. Why do that? Why try to make something really good not good? So just enjoy what you're doing. Take care of each other. Have fun. You know, something else I don't really understand is this mentality that when you are an officer, you can't be a part of the guys anymore. You got to have that separation. You can't have those relationships. I think that's crazy. I don't want to work for a supervisor that separates himself and doesn't want to have any kind of relationship with me. That's just, I don't get it. I can't truly build trust and build relationship with my crew without being a friend to them. So if you do that in the right way and build respect, build trust, they are going to respect you. It's just how it works. You know, they are not going to disrespect you in ways that's going to tear that down. You know, my station, I can honestly say I don't really do much supervising, much management at the station. I don't. And that's the way I want it. I want those things to be done by the guys that want to take my place. I want them to be learning those things. When we get on scene, that's when I am that's when I'm the officer. That's when I'm the supervisor. And they know that. And I'm very open to say, hey, if you see something, let me know because I need all your eyes. But at the end of the day, I'm the one making the decisions. So that's the way it's got to be. But building the relationship and ahead of time and all that, it makes that so easy because that respect is there, that trust is there. So just taking care of each other, being there for each other, having fun on the job is really something that I think is a big thing that if I could teach somebody is just enjoy what you're doing.
Yeah, I'm 100% with you. I've been a captain for about 15 years now. And when I got into the fire service, you know, there was always that separation, right, between the captain and the crew level. And they wanted you to continue to maintain that separation. And that didn't work out very well for me. You know, my guys hated me, you know, the relationship with them. And, you know, every time I asked to do something, right, it comes from a different level, you know, authoritative instead of respect. And it took me, you know, if you know my story, it took me that point to finally figure out, you know, that is not the right way to lead people. I mean, I'm with you, you know, you can't have that separation. Sure, on the fire ground, yep, you're 100% correct. But around the station, you know, goes back to the same thing. If you know your guys and you're taking care of them, they're going to take care of you. And you can't know your people right unless you're doing the things with them. So I feel like this is an old philosophy, and maybe it applies to somewhere in the business world, but it doesn't apply in the fire station as far as what I can see. And I'm sure there'll be plenty of people who would disagree with that, but I will challenge those people to convince me something different.
Yeah. That's just personally, I know that when I have been a part of crews that I love being a part of, that was a main focus. When I've been part of crews that I did not want to be a part of and did not enjoy being at work, that was what was gone. You know, it was the authoritative head of the household kind of personality that, you know, while you're outside working in 100 degree weather, pulling weeds out of the flower beds, they were inside reading magazines. And I hated that. I did not want to work for that person. And so that's kind of another lesson, I guess I could say, that if I was going to leave somebody with, is keep your eyes open. It's not just the good people that you learn from. It's not just the good influences. You learn a lot from the bad leaders, from the bad firefighters, you know, all that. If not only just to learn, this is not how I want to treat people, that's a big lesson to learn. So just, there's always something you can learn from everybody. And yeah, I mean, everybody's got different personalities, but I definitely don't want to work for that type of mentality, for sure.
Yeah, I agree with you. So what are your future goals? What are you working towards? The podcast? I know you're doing some writing, Instagram page, you know, Facebook page, you got a lot of things going on. Do we leave out anything?
Yeah, I think that's it right now. It's just like you do a lot of things halfway, but you don't do anything really good. I think that's kind of where I'm at right now. I'm trying to maybe get, I think writing is, it's something fun for me to really explore. I really want to try to get some things out there, and a lot of that's going to come with time, because I was not a good writer in school ever. I'm not a very good reader. So I've got a lot to learn. I'm like the master of run-on sentences. I think my wife is getting tired of being my editor, you know, cleaning my stuff up. But just learning and all these things, I've got, like I talked to you before we started the podcast, this whole podcast thing has been the most frustrating thing that I've ever been a part of. I cannot figure everything out. So I'm trying to learn about all that and just kind of getting better at all these things, you know, however I can reach people. I'm not a public speaker by any means. I mean, doing things like this right here a year or two ago would be way outside of my comfort zone. So just being a voice is something new to me, and something that I'm kind of trying to break into. So if it leads to some more public speaking, that'd be great. I just joined my volunteer department in the little town I work or I live in, just as a way to maybe reach more people, maybe see if I can help more. And so, you know, I'm excited about that too. Just another avenue of kind of what's next. And like I said earlier, I'm just trying to keep my eyes open and take advantage of any little opportunity I have, really.
I think you're doing an awesome job, and you're going to do great things. Is there anything that we didn't cover that you'd like to leave us with? Anything, any good nuggets you want to leave for the listeners?
No, I think we did a pretty good job of covering most everything. I mean, I just really just keep saying it over and over again. I think we really have to take care of our people right now. I mean, we're kind of experiencing a once in a lifetime event. Hopefully this isn't more than a once in a lifetime event, but you know, firefighters, you know, just the fire service in general has experienced a very high suicide rate, of very high suicide numbers here lately. And I believe the numbers from last year are double that of on-duty deaths. And it's something that, like I said, I'm not just super excited to get into, but it's a problem. And what makes that even more scary is that the situation we're in right now, you know, you got firefighters that are stuck in their stations because they can't go train or they can't go to the grocery store or really anything. We're quarantined inside unless we're called to go help somebody on a 911 call. And then these people go straight home because there's no gyms to work at or work out at, you know, there's nothing to do in between. So you go home, you're stuck inside at home. And I've kind of been trying to share that idea of, we really need to be focused on checking on each other right now, for sure. It's already a problem, but the situation that we're experiencing right now is only going to make that worse. And hopefully we're kind of towards the tail end of it, to where we can kind of loosen up some of the restrictions, and that'll help kind of get everybody back into the swing of things. But just keep an eye on your people. You know, it doesn't matter if you work with one person, if it doesn't matter if you're in charge of 100, you know, just keep an eye out, really be mindful that these are hard times. And just because you may be dealing with it like it's nothing, it might not be a big deal to you. It's not going to be that way with everybody. So just take care of your brothers and sisters and pay attention, really.
Now, this has been an awesome episode. Where can people find you? Where can they follow you?
I've got a Facebook page and an Instagram page, both under Crew First Culture. If you are needing to email me at all, you got any questions or things that you'd like to discuss with me, you can reach me at crewfirstculture@yahoo.com. I do have a podcast. I've got a couple episodes. They're super rough. I am not the lead commentator type personality, so I'm learning. But if you would like to listen to those, it's Crew First Culture. I believe right now they're on iTunes or Apple Podcasts and Spotify is where they're at now for sure. But yeah, just let me know. I mean, if there's something that I said that kind of speaks to you, that you would just like to have a conversation about, I'm open anytime. I really appreciate you having me on again. It's been really fun, and yeah, really enjoyed it.
Yeah, I have too. I've learned a lot from you, and that's I really enjoy doing these, opportunity to hear from other people's story. But I learn probably way more than the person telling their story. Just all the great content that you have, and I do really appreciate it. So thank you for being on.
Thank you. Keep doing good things yourself.
Thank you for listening to Enduring the Badge podcast. I'm your host, Jerry Dean Lund, and I want to personally thank you for listening. Don't forget to rate and review the show wherever you access your podcast. If you know someone that would be great on the show, please get a hold of me at Jerry Fire and Fuel on Instagram. And also, you can reach out to me on Enduring the Badge podcast on Instagram as well. Remember, the views and opinions expressed during the show represent our guests and hosts alone.